Let's go and look to our program. Here we have a loop in which we are incrementing some variable by one. Here we have count equal plus equal one. So count is increased by one. It starts with one. As long as the count is less than or equal to four, we print the count and increase this by one. Of course, this can easily be implemented with a for loop. This kind of problems, just incrementing something by some fixed value like one or some other value, are easier to implement with for loop. But this is just to show you how we can use while loop to do that. Because sometimes in the exam questions, I give you a problem, and in the question, it is mentioned that please don't use for loop, use a while loop. Okay. In this case, even if the problem can be solved with for loop, I want to measure if you know the while, how to build while loops. So please, in the question, if it says that don't use for loop, use while loop, then provide a solution which uses while loop. Okay. So here we have a while loop example. We start count with one before while we initialize count to one. And as long as count is less than or equal to four, we execute inside. Here we have print count and count plus equal one. The count is printed. It is increased by one. So after the first time it is one. One less or equal to four is true. One is printed. Here we see it. One is printed, and then count is increased by one. It becomes two. Comes back. Two is less or equal to four is true. Two is printed. So the second line will be printed here. And then count is increased by one again. It will become three. Three less than or equal to four is true. Three is printed. The third line is printed here. And then count is increased by one. It will become four. Four less or equal to four is true. So four is printed. Count will become five here. But now five less than or equal to four is false. It will finish the while loop and continue with line 9 here. And if we just print the count value after the while loop, we will see that after the while loop, the count value of count is equal to 5. Here we have another example. We start with 2, for example, but inside, as you see, the value of count is increased by 2. And again, here we have count less than 10 this time, and this will start with 2, and every time count will be incremented by 2, so it will get 2 for the values 2, 4, 6, 8, and 10. When it will become equal to 10, 10 less than 10 will be false, and it will exit the while loop. So the values 2, 4, 6, and 8 will be printed. After printing 8 here, when the count is increased by 2, it will become 10. It will come back to while loop. Count less than 10. 10 less than 10 will be false, and it will exit the while loop. Here we have another example. We are just decreasing the variable. We start with 10, for example, in this example. As long as seconds are greater or equal to 10, they will be printed. As you see, instead of going to the next line with and, I control that no new line will be printed, but just a space will be printed. And here, after the while loop is finished, we are just putting here backslash n, which means it's a new line character. So it goes to the next line and it will print after while loop, blah, blah. Here we are decreasing the seconds variable by one every time in the loop. So usually at the end of the loop, we have some statement which will affect this condition, okay? Due to this changing the while condition variable, at some time this will be false and the while loop will be finished. Here I have another example which is much more suitable for while loops. Here the user will enter numbers, okay? Let me run this program and I will show you it. to you. Here, it comes here. Enter a number. It says enter a number. It will input a number and it will convert it to integer. Let's say we are entering, for example, 4, okay? And then 1, 8, 7. And when I will press 0, the loop should end. So here it is not known from the beginning if the user will enter only one number which is not 0, or 10 number, or 100 number, or whatever, okay? So this kind of problems can be solved with while loop, okay? We don't know how many times the user will enter some non-zero number. So as long as the number value is non-zero, the loop will continue. But in order to have this condition, while n is not equal to zero, as long as it is not zero, we will continue. Only when it is zero, we will finish the while loop. In order to get to compute this logical expression, we have to know n. So here before while loop, we input the first number, okay? The first number here, the first line, the first number will be input with the input statement on line 33. The line 33 gets prints the enter a number 0 to stop and reads the number after it. Then we assign to max and min the value that is entered here, and then we start our while loop. As long as the number is not zero, since it is not zero, it's a valid number for us, we increment the count, we add the number to sum, we check if it is a maximum till now, or is it's a minimum till now, and then here we have another n equal int input blah blah. Okay, the same statement here on line 33 and 43. We have the same statement here in both line 33 and line 43, but here the second one, the line 43, is used to get all the subsequent numbers. Okay, to input all the subsequent numbers. Only the first one is taken before the while loop, and all the rest are read inside the while loop. Sorry. Why do we do that? Because in order to check if the value, the input value is not equal to zero, I have to input once before the while loop. And I have to input again inside the while loop in order to get the next and next and next, all the subsequent values. Because here, when the user will enter, for example, zero, it will be read from keyboard on line 43, and we will go to line 36 after that, because after the body of the while loop is finished, the condition is always checked again. In order to check here, the value here entered here, we have this condition already in while loop. So the value entered on line 43 is checked again on line 36. And then if the value is zero, then it will exit the loop and continue with line 44, okay? I've entered zero now. The maximum is 8, the minimum is 1, and the total is 8 plus 1, 9 plus 4. 13, 20, so the average is 5, it seems. And we see that we get the values correctly. So this is a much more common problem to use while loop. We don't know from the beginning how many times the while loop will execute, or the loop will execute. If you don't know the number of times the loop will execute, we usually use a while structure. Now I have, probably you have understood this because probably you have seen similar examples in CS 101, and now I will show you another example, the same example indeed. sum of input numbers, maximum minimum of input numbers till zero is entered. We will do the same thing again. But here we have input the number the first time outside the loop to check if the value is equal to zero or not. Here we will also see break statements in the second example. Here I have while true, which means that this loop will always repeat. It will never end, it seems, it may seem that it will never end, but we will end it with a break statement. Here I again set sum, max and min, blah, blah, to some values and count. And here inside while true, which is an infinite loop, we input the number from screen. Now let's enter the same values, but in different order, 7, 1, 8, 4, the same values and zero at the end. Yeah, here we have entered this. We are now running that part. Here we input a number from keyboard and we check if n is equal to zero or not. If n is equal to zero, we have a break statement, which means that it will finish the while loop. It will continue with line 67 here. Okay. We input a number. If the number is zero, then break the while loop. The while loop is terminated. If it is not zero, if n is not equal to zero, it will continue with the statement on line 61. It will increment the count. It will add the number to sum. If the number is greater than the previous max, the max will be set to the new number. If the new number is less than the previous minimum, the minimum will be set to the new number. And when these are finished, it will come back here and check the condition again. Since the condition is true, it will continue, okay? It will continue and it will go inside the loop again. The loop will only be terminated with the break statement here, okay? And the condition is that if the input number n is equal to zero, then terminate the while loop. So there are at least two ways of writing this. Here, when we get the first number, we set the max and min to the first number. And for any subsequent number, if the new number is greater than the previous max, we set max to new number. If the new number is less than the previous minimum, then this is the minimum, we set minimum to this number. And here we have something different. At the beginning, we don't know what are the max and min. So we set max to a small number, some negative here, I use minus 99 million, blah, blah, and minimum min to plus 99 million something, assuming that all the numbers, or assuming that at least some numbers will be between these two values, or not some numbers, all numbers will be between these two values. If all the numbers that we enter are greater than this one, all numbers that are entered are greater than 100 million, this program will not work, okay? And I have to put maybe some bigger values than in this case. If all the numbers are greater than this one, I will not be able to find the minimum. All the numbers are less than the max, initial max value, I will not be able to find the maximum, okay? So, but anyway, here I use this kind of things. Since I don't know at the beginning what are all values, if all values are bigger than 1 billion, this program will not work. Or all the values are less than minus 1 billion, this program will not work. Here we assume that the values that will be entered will be between minus 1 billion and plus 1 billion in this case. Try to figure out why. Just if I let's make this, for example, 999 and 999, and let's repeat this program again. Here we have no problem, 147, blah, zero. And here, since I set like this, I will enter minus some this value minus that minus this and minus, okay. What are, and then I will enter zero. What is the biggest number? The biggest number is this one. What is the smallest number? It is this one. Here it will not work correctly. You will see that it found the minimum correctly, but the maximum, which was minus 1204, is not true. It's since I started with max this one, since all the this is bigger than all the entered values, I will not be it will not compute correctly. Okay, just try to think a little bit about that. That's why let's put some bigger numbers. Okay, probably there will be no problem with that. Let's continue with one or more, with some more examples. Here we will be producing Fibonacci numbers which are less than 100. Okay, what are Fibonacci numbers? The first two Fibonacci numbers are 1 and 1. Okay, sometimes they start with 0 and 1, but then it comes to the same time, same thing. 1 and 1. The next value is the sum of the previous two value. 2 is equal to 1 plus 1. And then what we do, we have 1, 1, 2. We add the last two values. 1 plus 2 is equal to 3. 2 plus 3 is equal to 5. 3 plus 5 is equal to 8, etc. So here I will use two variables, A and B. A is assigned 1, B is assigned 1. We print A, we print B. The first two values are printed. 1 and 1 are printed. And then what we do, we assign the value of B. A is one, the value 1 before, and B is the last value, okay? B is the last value, and the A value is the previous one. So what we do, we put the last value to the previous one, and we add A and B, the last two values are added and put to the last one. So we shift the variables. At the beginning, A and B are 1 and 1. The second time, A is 1, B is 2. Then A is 2, B is 3. Then A is 3, B is 4, etc. So we continue like that using that statement. And we check if the last value, which is B, is less than 100. Then we print the B, and we again repeat the same operation here. Okay. Try to understand this by yourself. So every time B is the last number, the last number is assigned to the previous number. A is the previous one. And we add last two values, and the new last value is changed here. They are all shifted. After, we can print here after the loop, what is B? Let's go here. Let's 1, 4, blah, blah, 0. And let's look to the loop. After the loop, we have 1, 4, 4 as the value of B. Okay. Here, 1, 4, 4, B becomes at one point, not less than 100, then the loop will be finished. And then after the loop, we check, we see that the B is 144, which is 55 plus 89. Here we have another example. We assume that there is 1,000 bacteria in some medium, and every minute, the number of the population of the bacteria increases by 21%. 21% means 0.21, okay? This is equivalent to, this is the same thing with 21%. So what we do, we compute the population, new population of the bacteria. How do we do that? This is the previous population plus growth rate multiplied by the population. At the beginning, the population is 1,000. 1,000 plus the growth rate, 21%, which is 0.21, multiplied with what, with 1,000. So what we will get? We will get 210. 21% of 1,000 is 210. Plus 1,000, the new population will be 1,221. Why do we convert to int? Because the growth rate is that float number, the multiplication will produce, may produce some decimal parts. Since the number of bacteria is an integer number, I just convert it to integer, okay? Because the result of this expression may be a float number. Let's see why it is like that. Let's make this, and let's run it. And here 1, 2, 4, 0. Here, as you see, this is real number, dot one, dot blah, blah, dot blah, blah. In order to not get these numbers, I just used here int, okay? Because when I have a float number, which is 0 point something, multiplied with some population, I may get some decimal parts, okay? In order not to get decimal parts, I just put here, I just convert the result of this to integer. And I print the minute. Here I start the minute 0. Inside the while loop, the minute is increased by 1. At the beginning, the time is 0. After the first minute, minute variable is increased by 1. The new population at the end of that minute is computed with this formula. And here the minute and the population are printed. Okay. Here, let's run this again and see it. 1, 2, 4, 0. Okay, here we have, sorry, here we have our output. This minute one population, minute two population, etc. are printed inside the while loop. As long as the new population is less than 2,000, we continue our operation. We don't know how much time, how many time it will be executed, okay? The only criteria for us is that what is the population? The population was at the beginning 1,000. We are interested in how much time it will take the population to double. Okay, since the double of 1,000 is 2,000, as long as it is less than 2,000, we will continue. Here we see that it after, as if it is less than 2,000, we increment the population, then we minute, we compute the new population. And we print the population. If now the population is greater than or equal to 2,000, then next time when we check the condition, it will be false. Okay. At one time, population will be 2,000 here, greater than 2,000. We will print the population which is greater than 2,000 here. Come back, and this condition will be false because population is no longer less than 2,000, okay? So we are printing this. Here we have a break. By the way, be very careful using continue with while statements. Break is perfect, okay, as I've shown you here in that example, okay? But usage of continue is problematic in while loops. Try to avoid using continue in while loops because you have to be very careful. You may end up with some infinite loops because here you have usually a condition and somewhere in the loop there is a statement which changes the variable used in the condition. Okay, here we have a condition, count less than this. If I don't have that, count is plus equal one, count plus equal one, repeat is repeating twice. If I don't write the line 117, if I omit this line, this program will never stop because when count will be equal to 5, okay, we will come to this condition, continue will directly skip the rest and come back here and check again. When it is 5, count greater than or equal 5 and count less than 8 will be true. If I don't have this statement, I only have continue inside that. If I have, for example, let's make this comment. It will never stop, okay? It will never stop because count will be 5. When count is 5, this condition will be true. It will continue. Count is still 5. It will come back here with continue. It will jump to the condition again. 5 less or equal to 10 is true. It will come here. Since the count is 5, this will be true, continue, true, continue, this condition is true, it will never change the count value and the loop will continue forever. Okay, count will be fixed to 5 and it will not stop anyway. So when you use continue with while loops, please be very careful to change the variable which is used in the condition. This is one thing about continue. In the meantime, I've already explained to you the break and continue statements. When in a loop, in a for loop or in a while loop, when there is a break statement, when the break statement is executed, the loop is finished. It continues with statement after the loop, okay? After the whole loop. In continue statement, it just, if in a for loop, it just skips the rest in the loop and continue with the next value in the range, okay? Or next value in the list. We will see those later on. But with while loops, as I said, continue is quite dangerous. I suggest you not to use continue if possible. Try to solve it in another way. Usually you don't need continue in while statements anyway. But you may use break statements in while loop for some cases, as I've shown you here. Here, for example, I have if count is greater than 7 break. What it does, it will not go until the end. When count will become greater than 6, it will break, and we will see that where it is, while and break, it is here. Here we have after while loop, here we have, we start with 1. As long as count is less than or equal to 10, that we expect it will be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, because count is increased by 1. We print the count, 1 is printed, 2 is printed. Assume that 6 is printed as well. When it comes here, 6 is greater than 6. No, it doesn't execute it here. Count will become 7. 7 less or equal to 10 is true. 7 will be printed. But now 7 greater than 6 is true. It will break. So instead of going until 10, it will break when count will become greater than 6. In other words, when it will become 7. But since it is printed before, 7 is printed. 7 greater than 6 is true. It breaks and it exits the while loop. We have here 1, 2, 7. Let's change this a little bit. Let's just take print count from here and let's put it here, okay? I have print count after this. What will happen in this case? Here, it will only print up to 6. Why? When it will become 6, 6 greater than 6 will be false. Okay. It will not break. It will print 6. But when it will count will become 7, this is 7 less than 10 is true. 7 greater than 6 is false. It will break. So 6 will be printed last time, but 7 will not be printed. So depending on where you put the other statements in the loop before the if statement, which contains break, is important. You have to be careful when you use break as well. Any questions about while statements and break? I will finish the while and break and continue statement subjects now. Do you have any questions about that? You know these from CS 101 already, so I will move to Python function chapter. Okay, what are functions? Functions are some small programs, program parts, which performs a specific task, okay? Each function has a specific task. Usually we don't make functions too complicated. They may be complicated, but usually a function performs only one specific task. Try not to put two or more tasks in the same function, So if there are two or three tasks that has to be performed, it is better to write two or three functions, one function for each task, okay? For example, let's see what are, there are some built-in functions. Let's start with built-in functions. Python has a number of built-in functions. How do we use the functions? Every function has a name and every function has parameters or arguments. When we call a function, I will just use here, we have ups. I will have max and min, okay. A function, for example, ups function, let's start with ups function. Ups function gives us the absolute value of its argument. Here we have x is equal to minus 48.7. Let's just use this. Absolute value of 48.7 is blah blah. Here the value, this value 48 plus 48.7 is produced by the function called ups. When we call a function, if the function returns a value to us, the value replaces the function call. Okay, x is minus 48.7, so ups x is equal to gives us or returns us plus 48.7. That value replaces this. Okay, this is an expression, but this expression only contains one function call, and the function returns some value in this case, and that value is replaced by itself, by the function call. So ups x is replaced by the value which is returned by the ups function. Let's do some other example. Let's say y is equal to, for example, ups x divided by, for example, floor division 10. And let's print y. Here, again, I have a function call in an expression. I have a mathematical expression here, an arithmetic expression, and there is a function called inside the expression. What happens? The function is called, the function gives us back some value, and that value replaces the function call here. So ups x is replaced with plus 48.7, and we have floor division, and then the computation continues for this expression, okay? But first, the function is called, a value replaces here, and then the rest is performed. Let's run this again. Here we see that it is 4. Plus 48.7, floor division 10, gives us 4.0. When you divide this by 10, floor division 10, it is 4.87, but floor divisions omits the decimal part, so we have only 4.0. Here we have another example, n is equal to 16. Absolute value of 16 is again 16, so we get again ups and returns 16. It gets as parameter 16, but it returns us again 16. So we get this printed out with line 13. Here we have several variables. A is equal to 8, B is equal to 34, C is equal to 7, D is equal to 12. Here we see max and min functions, okay? By the way, if in your program you use, for example, a variable max is equal to 22, sorry, let's remove this. Then when you do that, when you use a variable with the function name, then the function name will not work usually, okay? So try not to use a variable name with function name. Max is a function, min is a function. Let's also have another function. We have also sum function. Let's use here sm. And let's print the sum. Sum is equal to, comma, sm. Now this will work fine because for some, but for max we may have problem. Let's run this. As you see, I've defined a variable named max. Since max, the word max is used in my program as a variable, now it will not recognize the max function, okay? So that's why I suggest you use either max1, variable max1, or some mx or something like that. Don't use those names as variable names, okay? If I do this now, it will be no problem. Oh, because I have a problem here, because sum has is used somewhere else. Where is this? Do we have a sum function? We have a sum function. What is wrong? Let me check if I've used. Yeah, because the sum function requires a list. Here, if I just put some another parenthesis, it will be fine. Then it will work. Yeah, now it will work. With single parenthesis, it doesn't work. Sum requires either a list or a tuple, okay, or a set. So I just converted this to a tuple. As you know from previous semester, a tuple contains several elements between parentheses. Now, I have a tuple consisting of A, B, C, and D. Sum gets the sum of the values in the tuple made by the values A, B, C, D. So if I had, for example, a variable named sum, this will not work because sum is a variable. Here, it will not be able to understand that sum on line 20 is a function. Okay, it will confuse the system. As you see, it will not work correctly. So please don't use the word sum, max, min as variable names. Instead, either use mx or use max1. Max1 is fine. Sum1 is fine. So here, let's use max1, etc. Don't use the word max, min, and sum as variable names in your programs. If you use them, you cannot use max, min, and sum functions. If you don't use max, min, and sum functions, okay, that's fine. Then you can use the variable names max, min, and sum. Let's continue with that. Round function just rounds the values here. Two means that just round two decimal digits. I will just do one more thing. See. Oops. Okay. With only zero here. And let's see the output. Here, as you see, we get eight. Zero means don't get any round just from the digital part, the decimal part, don't get any fractional part. So since the next one is eight, it is rounded up. This results with eight. His two means that after two decimal digits rounded up, the next one is five. So it rounds up. 89 becomes 90, and we see 7.9. And similar things happens here. I will not go and explain round function in detail. You understand from here that if you give several values to a max function, it will find the maximum. If you give several values to min, it will give you minimum. But in sum, the parameter must be either a list or a tuple or a set. It doesn't get accept individual values. Originally it was like this. Here I have four parameters in the sum, then it will not work because sum doesn't work like that. In order to get to use sum, we have to have either a tuple or a list or a set or a structure which contains many values in it. So here, when I put two parentheses, the first parenthesis is, sorry, let's remove this. The first parenthesis is the parenthesis of the sum function. The second parenthesis here, up to here, defines a tuple. You know from some previous semester that tuples are written between parentheses. So we have a tuple here, and it will compute the sum of all the values in the tuple, which contains, in this example, A, B, C, and D values. Here, how we can use it, in this example, we have ups function called as parameter of the pow function, and then round function is called again, and we get a value from here, then the pow function is the power function. Ups minus 2 will give us plus 2. Round 4.3 will give us 4. Pow 2 to the power 4 will be 16. Let me do another example here. Z is equal to, for example, max of ups of minus 4, comma, pov 1.2, comma 2.3, comma, let's put here just, I'll just round 2.384, comma 1. What I did here, I have a max function call, and max function call has parameters separated by comma. This is the first parameter. This is the second parameter until this comma here. This is the third parameter. Of course, let's print Z. So in this case, how this statement is executed? Since there is a max function call, ups function call, pov, and round function calls here, first of all, the function calls inside the parentheses of the max, or which are the parameters of the max, are executed. So ups minus 4 is executed, a value comes here. Pov 1.2, 2.3 is executed, a value comes here. This round function is executed, a value comes here. Now we have three values. One value returned by ups function, one value returned by the pov function, one value returned by the round function. I will even do one more thing. Round 2.304, blah, blah, comma 3, for example, okay? In this case, in order to run the pov function, the parameters must be evaluated. 1.2, no problem. Here, the second parameter of the pov function is round blah, blah, blah. So what happens? Round blah, blah is executed. A value is returned. The value returned value comes and replaces this part. And then we have two values, 1.2 and the result of this round function call. Then the two values are ready. And then the pov function can be executed. It will be executed. A value will be replaced here. The function, the value that is returned by the pov function will replace this, and then the round function call will be performed. A value will replace here, and then we have all three values, and then the max function can be executed after all the inner function calls are performed. Okay. So if we can have this kind of function calls nested in each other, you shouldn't be worried about that. Start with the inner one. Here we have ups, we can execute this. In order to execute pov, the parameters must be ready. 1.2 is already fixed. We have to execute this. So round function is first executed, and then pov function is executed, okay? Let's run this and let's see some values. Okay, here we have those. This is how we use functions, Python functions. How do we define our own functions? Let's move on to defining functions. In the meantime, what I will do, I will just edit this. Here I will, from my folder, we have if statement, for statements, blah, blah. We will put while statement, break and continue statement, Python 1 functions. Let's take these three, put them here, save changes. Okay, now in the instructive Python programs folder, there is while, break and Python functions programs that I've just shown you today. Now let's continue with defining functions. We can define our own functions. As I said before, every function should perform a specific and well-defined task. Okay. How do we write a function? We start with the def keyword. After def keyword, of course, we put a space and we give a name to our function. The function names obeys the same rules with the variable names. They can start with a letter, an underscore, and then they may contain letters, underscore, and digit characters. They cannot contain any other character. Only letters, digits, and underscore are allowed in the function names. And of course, the first character of the function name cannot be a digit. It can be either underscore or a letter character. And then after the function name, we put parentheses, between parentheses, parameters. The parameters are separated by comma. Let's go and look to our defining functions. Here, for example, I have only the function convert to Celsius, which only contains one parameter. By the way, a function may contain zero parameter, one parameter, two or more parameters. I will show you with I will write here a function which doesn't contain any parameters. Let's write the function def print 1 underscore 10. This function doesn't contain any parameter. Why? Because the purpose of this function prints 1 to 10. What are these three, the string with three double quotation mark? This is just an explanation about the function. Here I will have for n in range 1, 1, 11. So this will produce the values from 1 to 10, okay? Range 1, 11 will produce values from 1 to 10. And we will print, for example, those values. So here we will just call this one print 1 underscore 10. Function is called, and let's print here our famous 40 multiplied by 1 equal sign, just to separate from the rest. Let's run this. Here you see that 1 to 10 are printed. Here this function does not have any parameter because its purpose is just to print values from 1 to 10. Therefore, we don't need to give it to it any parameter. It is a simple function of printing from 1 to 10. So a function may have zero parameter, may have one parameter, or may have more than one parameter. Here in the second example, we have a convert to Celsius function, which gets a Fahrenheit value, and it will compute the corresponding Celsius value for this Fahrenheit temperature and return the Celsius. Here we have only one statement, return, and an expression. This expression will be computed. There is a round function call here, Fahrenheit minus 32 divided by 1.8 is the conversion formula to Celsius. What I will do, I will just copy this. Go here. Okay, let's put here that. Now it will probably accept that. Instead of round, I will just use this one. This is how to convert a Fahrenheit to Celsius. Subtract 32 from Fahrenheit and divide the result to 1.8. This will give you Celsius. Let's run this. As you see in here, Fahrenheit 72 is 22 point blah, blah, blah. Fahrenheit 483 is this one. But I'm not interested in that much precision, okay? I'm just interested in, for example, only two-digit precision. So what I do, let's put here this one, and let's remove this from here. I round the value given here by two decimal digits. So when I run this, I will see that it is this one and this one. Here it was 5555. After 5, the next one was 5, so it's rounded up to 6. So what happened? I'm calling the convert to Celsius function with 72, okay? F is equal to 72. I could directly write here 72. The result would be same, and I can omit this line, okay? The result will not be different. But in this case, I will not have this F value. In order to have this F variable, I just have to it something like this, okay? The function, the same function is called twice. Here it is plus, not plus 10. Let's do it properly. So 483 is equal, the Fahrenheit 483 is equal to this one. Do you have anybody read? There is a novel named Fahrenheit 483. Had anybody read this novel? It's a famous science fiction novel. I will check if I have this novel in my library or is it in Ankara. Probably I didn't bring that one here. No, probably that book is Ankara yet. It's a very famous novel written in 1950 by George Orwell. I suggest you to read that novel if you like reading. Anyway, let's continue with our programs. Here I have a print multi which has two parameters. And what it does, it print multi, it prints a value A and time, okay? With 4 and 7, it prints 4, 7 times. ABC is printed 4 times, as you see. 4.702 is printed 3 times. The second parameter is how many times the first parameter will be printed. Here you see A and N. Here there is a loop for k in range n. Therefore, this loop will repeat n times. Range n will produce numbers from 0 to n minus 1. In other words, it will repeat n times, and the first parameter is printed, okay? So a print multi function gets two parameters, and it prints the first argument, the second argument times, okay? If n is 3, it will print 3 times. If n is 7, it will print 7 times the first argument. Let's see. We have print range. Prints numbers between two given numbers. If the question in the exam is write a Python function that prints numbers between two given numbers, and on the same line, then your answer will be this function, okay? From line 41 to 44. What it does, it gets two parameters between two given numbers, n1 and n2. Here, we built a for loop starting using range function, starting with n1 up to n2 plus 1, because I want to print n2 as well. Including n1 and n2, both are inclusive. I want to print all of them. Since I want to print the numbers on the same line, here in the print, I use and equal one space. If I don't put this, it will print on different lines. Here I see those numbers 4, 5, 6, 7, because it is 4 to 7 on line 47, the function is called. They are printing on the same line. If I don't put this, if I omit this, what will happen? It will print K, it will go to the next line. It will print new K, it will go to the next line. Every number that is printed will be on a different line. But the questions say, print them on the same line. That's why here we have to have and equal space. And since this doesn't go to the next line, after printing all the values, I have to print a new line to finish the line, okay? To go to the next line and stop there. So that's why we have here a print after the for loop. It will print 4, 5, 6, 7 in the loop. And after the loop is finished, print will go to the next line. If I don't have this print here, let's comment it out. What will happen? As you see, 4, 5, 6, 7 is printed. It stays on the same line. 4, 3, blah, 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 blah are printed. This one are printed. And print range 7 to 6 doesn't print anything. Why? Because here this is there is no third parameter in the range function, which means that the increment is by plus 1. And since the second number is less than the first one, the range will produce no number. Okay, it will not produce anything. It will not print anything. So that's why this doesn't produce any number. Probably you understand why we have a print here. Since it stays on the same line on this print, when before finishing the print range, we want to go to the next line. So we have a print here. Otherwise, we will have this kind of output. Now we have all separately printed on each line. Here we have some other methods. Print range. Now this time it is the same thing with the first one. Print numbers between two given numbers. But here, since the second number in the third function call on line 49 was less than the first one, here we are fixing that. If the first number is greater than the second number, what we do, if the first number is less than or equal to second number, then we print normally. Otherwise, if the first number is not less than or equal to second number, if the first number is greater than the second number, which means that if this is not true, if this is false, it will mean that n1 is greater than n2. In this case, we again start with n1, but now we decrease because we know that n1 is greater than n2. We start with n1, go to the n2 minus 1 by decreasing. If this is 7, if this is 6, 7, 6 minus 1, 5, 7 to 5 by minus 1, it will print 6 and 7. Sorry, 7 and 6. Let's see it here. Print range 2. Here we have 7 and 2, which is decreasing. It will print 7, 6, 5, 4, blah, 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 because it will print, it will use the else part. N1 less is less than N2. Here, N1 is less than N2. So this if condition is false. Therefore, it will go to else part and will execute the else part. But the second time we call this print range two function. The first parameter is greater than the second parameter, so it will print 4, 5, blah, blah, up to 10. Do you understand this? Of course, when I ask this kind of questions, I will give some more explanation with some examples. I will probably say that if the parameters are 7 and 2, it should produce something like that. If the first parameter is less than the second one, if the second one is greater, it will produce something like that. I provide more explanations in the questions, but you have to read the questions very carefully and to try to understand fully, completely, okay? Don't just read one or two words from the question and jump back to writing the answers. Please, first of all, try to understand completely, very clearly, and then write the program corresponding to the question. Prints positive even numbers up to 10. This is fixed, so it doesn't require any parameter. Positive even numbers up to 10, including 10. What are the positive numbers up to 10 and including 10? They are 2, 4, 6, 8, and 10, okay? So here we will have print even 5. I named this function like that. And here we don't have any parameter because the question doesn't require any parameter. So we have here 2 to the 11. 10 is inclusive, so we end up at 11. And increment is by 2. We print the values, so we get this. Boom, 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 boom. Here there are some other examples. Just read and try to understand these ones, okay? I'm just looking for some interesting functions. Yeah, prime function is quite interesting. Here I have two versions of the isPrime function. This isPrime function gets an integer number and returns either false or true. If the given number is a prime number, it returns true. If the given number is not a prime number, then it will return false. The prime numbers start from 2, okay? 2, 3, 5, 7 are prime numbers. So any number, any integer number, which is less than 2 is not a prime number. So we directly return false if the given number is less than 2. It is not a prime number. Then if it is not less than 2, if it is equal or greater than 2, we have this way of solving it. Here we start from 2 and go until n minus 1. Range 2, n will produce numbers from, let's remove this, 2, 3, blah, 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 up to n minus 1. Okay, it will produce those numbers, 2, 3, 4, blah, blah. What do we do? We check if n, our parameter, is divisible by any number from 2 to n minus 1. If it is divisible by any number up to itself, then it's not a prime number. Then we return false. If this loop is finished, it never returns. It means that if n is not divisible by any number smaller than itself, then it's a prime number, then it returns true. Is this function understood? It is quite important to understand because this is a very nice and instructive example, function example. It contains some logic insight. So we check here in the for loop if the number is divisible by a smaller number than itself, up to itself. 2, n ensures that it goes until n minus 1. And if it is divisible by a number smaller than itself, then it is not a prime number, it returns false. Otherwise, if the for loop is finished, it is not divisible by any number, then it will return true, which means that it's a prime number. Here, we have the same thing, but instead of going until n, we go to until n to the power 0.5 square root of n plus 1. This is enough, because if a number is not divisible to any integer number which is less or equal to its square root, then it cannot be divided by any number greater than its square root, okay? This is a mathematical fact. We use that. Why do we use this? Here, I will show it. I will just run this. Here, prime numbers. Is this 10 million? Yeah, 10 million and 10 million 100. Here it waited quite some time to compute this, but it very fastly found this. Let's make this 900 and 900 and let's run this program once more. Now we are waiting. It is doing some computation. It found one number. It's the next number. Next number. And one more. This is slow. Why? Because we divide up to 10 million something. Okay, we repeat this loop 10 million times. Okay, that's why it finds slowly. Let's stop this. Let's just, instead of 900, let's change this to 200 to see it more. Here now we are waiting for the first one. We are now at this level, okay? One is found, and the next one, because is prime is very slow. For each number, for example, that number, it starts from 2 until 1 less than itself. It divides, it tries to find those numbers, so it is quite slow, as you see. But when these are finished, you see the rest is computed very fast. Because the second time, this statements here, 163 to 165, and 167 to 169 is almost same, except in one we called is prime, in the second one we called is prime 2. It seems, as you see, is prime 2 is very fast, because it didn't, and the result is same. Okay, if you look here, the result is same, but this program performs much faster. For this example, it performs about 5 million times faster, okay? Imagine 5 million times faster than the first one, when the number is about 10 million. For smaller numbers, of course, the difference is not that much big. For numbers up to 100, 1,000, etc., the difference is not that much big. But if the number is 10,000, it will be 5,000 faster. If the number is 100, it will be 50 times faster, okay? Because we go until the, sorry, not 50, even 10 times, more than that, 10 times faster. It just goes to the square root of n plus 1. So if it is 10 million, square root of 10 million is 3,000. Instead of performing 10 million operations, it will perform only 3,000 operations, so it will be 3,000 times faster. Anyway, let's continue with this. Now that's the end of our examples here. Here we have an interesting function. Try to understand this by yourself. And this is just for fun. I've written this function for fun. Try to understand that function. 22, blah, blah. Okay. Now I will finish my lecture. Do you have any questions about functions? I'm trying to give as many examples as possible because examples clarifies most of the time the your mind, because you see very different examples, and using seeing those examples, you have a better idea of how to write a new function when a question is asked to you. Doing exercises, doing more exercise will ease your ability of programming. That's why I'm showing many examples. I hope this is fine with you. Any questions?
Can I ask about quiz?
Yes.
Is that next week, 5. 5. 5. haftada yapacaktınız ya quiz hocam. Quiz haftaya mı?
Quiz'i haftaya. Evet, haftaya bir quiz yapacağım. Next week there will be a quiz. I will go to here. The midterm will be on week 9. So I will do quiz on week 6, okay? Here the quiz will be on week 6, and on week 9 there will be midterm. So let's change this quiz. I will move the quiz to week 6. The midterm will be on week 9. Okay? So next week there is no quiz. The quiz will be on week of 5 April. The quiz will be on that week.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. By the way, there is a homework given to you. The due date is 31 March. As I've informed you a few days ago, there will be tutoring session today at 5 o'clock. Okay. In the meantime, let me stop the recording.